100 years ago, a group of Scottish women made an extraordinary journey into wartime Europe, pioneering female medics on a mission to nurse the frontline wounded. They called it their great adventure. It would end up closer to a horror story.
They wanted to prove that they could fight, that they were equal to men.
I mean, these women, they broke the mould. There was no chance that we're going back to the old days.
They never considered walking away from it. They were every bit as good as the men in the family.
The amazing thing to me is the frame of mind in which most of us started off. An intense excitement. We're going to the war, isn't it marvellous? We were young, and to us it was going to be a wonderful adventure. Well, it was, but not in the sense that we had imagined. Edinburgh, St Andrew Square, where it all started 100 years ago, at the headquarters of the Scottish Suffrage Society. Here, a group of female doctors, nurses and volunteers were on a mission to prove their worth amongst the men with a new all-women venture, the Scottish Women's Hospitals. Between 1914 and 1918, over 1,500 women joined the organisation and went to nurse on Europe's fighting fronts. It all started with one woman, Dr Elsie Inglis, one of Scotland's first female surgeons and a prominent suffragette. When war broke out, Inglis asked the War Office for permission to take female medical units to Europe. Their response? My dear lady, go home and sit still. Not one to be defeated, she wrote to other nations and her offer was quickly accepted by France and Belgium. Then a cry for help came from Serbia, 2,000 miles away in Eastern Europe. Elsie and her ladies didn't hesitate. In December 1914, the women set off for the small Balkan nation, an ally fighting alone and in dire need. Sadly, some of them would never return.
These women from Scotland, you know, took up the challenge and went out there in such really difficult circumstances. This was really their big moment in time. This really was their big adventure.
Alan Cumming from Cumbernauld isn't perhaps your typical war historian. But for the last 5 years, Alan, a landscape gardener, has become something of an authority on the Scottish women's hospitals. He discovered the story during a trip to Serbia to watch football. And it's the Serbian part that's particularly captivated him.
I was visiting Belgrade in Serbia and I came across a plaque on the wall and I couldn't read the writing because it was in acrylic, but I could clearly see the name Elsie Inglis. I was aware that she was from Scotland, I was aware that she was a doctor, but I really would have been hard pushed to have said any more than that. And when I got back to the Serb company that I was in, I asked them about it and I was quite surprised and embarrassed actually as to how in detail they knew the story and how warm they spoke of Elsie Inglis.
Alan's mission is to catalogue all 1,500 women who made up the Scottish Women's Hospitals and to bring their stories back to life.
Someone said to me a couple of years ago I would be running a website, that I would be, you know, writing articles for newspapers and magazines and I'd be researching and everything else. I would have just laughed at them because, I mean, really, my idea of writing was sending someone a text. And then when I found out that no one was actually going to pick up the reins and do something about the story during the centenary year, I thought, well, maybe I should give it a go.
Serbia. Now peaceful, this small Balkan nation has been no stranger to conflict over the course of its history. In the summer of 1914, Serbia found itself at the heart of events that sparked the First World War when the Austrian heir to the throne, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, was assassinated during a visit to Bosnia. 2 months later, Europe was in the grip of a war that would last 4 years. The First World War, which claimed around 37 million lives. Serbia was an ally, but at first its army fought alone with massive losses. The Scottish women's hospitals were among the first foreign relief missions to arrive.
Serbia was a great ally during World War I. And in fact, the first ever Allied victory was in Serbia. And Serbia was doing a heck of a job holding its own.
100 years on, the women of the Scottish women's hospitals are all but forgotten in their homeland. But in Serbia, their work and the sacrifices they made are still honoured in ceremonies held around the country every year.
Again we pray for the repose of the souls of the servants of God, Elizabeth, Mabel and Lorana, departed this life, and that they may be pardoned all of their sins, both voluntary and involuntary.
Elsie Inglis was a woman ahead of her time. She was one of Scotland's first female surgeons and a leading suffragette. And it was from this unconventional background that many of the first volunteers came.
Yeah, Elsie would have been someone who would have very much known her own mind. She would have been a very, very difficult and tricky customer. One very determined lady.
By the end of the war, the Scottish women's hospitals would attract women from all over the world. But in the early days, they were mostly from Scotland.
They came from the Highlands and the Islands. Some of the women came from very, very well-to-do houses. And often they were the daughters of the local minister or a doctor or so forth. But a lot of them were very ordinary women as well.
Evelina could have stayed in that castle or stayed behind in Scotland. She didn't want it. You know, she wanted to have a life full of meaning.
The Honourable Evelina Haverfield, born at Inverlochy Castle in the Highlands of Scotland and renowned for her independent spirit. When she wasn't travelling the world, Evelina was an active member of the Scottish suffrage movement and through this became great friends with Dr. Inglis. It was a friendship that would lead to her biggest adventure of all.
She heard Mrs. Pankhurst speak, and that's when she decided she was going to give up hunting until the women got the vote. And she became a militant suffragette and a prominent British lesbian. She struck up a friendship, which lasted for the rest of her life, with a young actress, Vera Holm, also known as Jack. And together, they would ride their beautiful horses at the head of the big suffragette parades. She went to jail. She stood trial with Mrs. Pankhurst. And then the First World War came along.
Evelina didn't join up as a nurse. She was an administrator.
With her language skills and because she knew a lot of the diplomats and the people in high places, she was able to find the place to set up the hospital and bring in the people to do the laundry and run the hospital. And her intimate friend, Vera, drove the ambulances.
Alan is planning a trip to Serbia as part of his research. Before he goes, he's visiting the Mitchell Library in Glasgow, which holds the records of the Scottish women's hospitals.
Hi, Alan.
Afternoon, Lynn. How are you?
Good, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, great. I'm fine. Yeah, absolutely. Brilliant. What have you got for me?
I've got some photograph albums for you to have a look at. I don't think you've ever seen these before, so take a seat and let's have a look through them. This is an album from the first Serbian unit.
Okay.
So have a look at it.
So this is really December 1914.
Yep.
And when was the Mitchell given this material?
This came to us in 1922. got more material in 1928 when the organisation was wound up.
Yeah.
So how did they get to Serbia?
Well, there was three main ports that would have been used. One at Southampton, one at Newport in Wales, and one from Cardiff. The route took them past the Rock of Gibraltar, just off the coast of Africa, and up into Salonika. And as they got nearer Greece, I mean, things certainly would have been even more dangerous because, you know, they had the Zeppelins overhead, you had the German Austrian aircraft, there was mines in the water. The women thought it was quite thrilling. It was a very, very dangerous time.
It was an amazing organisational process even to get all of that out there.
Yeah.
And to then start looking after these people, where it all started.
Well, I'm looking forward to going out there, you know. It's very exciting to do that.
Coming up in part two, Alan is off to Serbia. A contrast to the journey taken by the first unit of the Scottish Women's Hospitals 100 years ago.
And there was dead, dying, recovering, very badly wounded people in filthy conditions.
It is. It's actually very moving, just being here. Yeah.
One 100 years ago, a group of female medics left Scotland for wartime Europe, travelling 2,000 miles to Serbia, an allied nation fighting alone. The Scottish women's hospitals are all but forgotten in their homeland, but one man is on a mission to bring their stories back to life. Alan Cumming from Cumbernauld in Scotland is a landscape gardener turned historian. He is in Serbia to find out more about his country's forgotten wartime heroines. Very different scenes would have greeted the women on their arrival in the middle of winter, 1914. The patients are lying mostly on straw mattresses on the floor or on wooden beds, with only a rug over them and often only the clothes which they had on in the battlefield. It seems to me the Serbs have been overwhelmed with the sick and wounded and scarcely know how to tackle things.
There was no form of sanitation. There was dead, dying, recovering, very badly wounded people in filthy conditions.
Loch Inver in the Scottish Highlands, birthplace of two of the first nurses to travel to Serbia. Sisters Mary and Flo McKenzie travelled there in 1915 in different units. Their stories have passed down through their family.
They were born in this house in the late 19th century. Brought up here. There was 10 of a family, quite a large family in those days. This was a very remote part of Scotland in those days, serviced by a steamer from Glasgow, which was a long way away. They were fine women, but they were good characters.
Yes. Quite fearless and quite strong-willed. They never told us of being involved in any activities in relation to the suffrage movement. That, of course, wouldn't be terribly socially acceptable in a crofting community. Mary said that when she went out, the conditions were horrific. The first thing that they had to do was burn mattresses, burn nearly everything, and set up some form of hygiene, cleanliness. She really felt for the Serbian people. And they never considered walking away from it because the people were in such need.
The Elsie Inglis' units came out with this totally new, fresh ideas, and they were in uniform. They whitewashed the buildings. Everything was scrubbed down, and it was a very new approach. And quickly, the Serbs soon all wanted to be in those hospitals.
The city of Krakovitz in central Serbia. This city park was once the site of the country's first field hospital set up by the Scottish women. Alan has met a local historian to get an idea of the layout here 100 years ago.
The map of Krakovice is from 1897.
Oh, really? 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 So, what if we...
Can I have a look at this, please? Yeah.
We are here.
All right, okay, okay.
And this is where the tents were.
Right, okay, so that then
this really this entire area would have been tents.
Cita oblast, to su bili šatori.
Da, cita oblast, ove, jer tu je uopšte bilo nije bilo naselje ovde.
There was just a field. There was nothing like it is here. Now there is a map university.
And the tents themselves, the what size would these tents have been?
Sami šatori, koje su veličine bili?
Pa to su bili baš oni pravi poljske vojne bolnice.
A few dozens of people were in a tent.
So we're talking about 20, 30 people to a tent, really. What were the most common types of operation that would have happened here?
Most general operation would be amputating arms, legs, taking the ammo out of the bodies.
Wow.
And everything that these people could do and their equipment allowed them to do, because it was they were very poor on equipment, on medical stuff.
But the Scottish women weren't just dealing with the war wounded. There was another killer at large. Typhus fever, a cold weather disease spread by lice, was reaching epidemic proportions. With so few doctors and nurses of its own, Serbia relied on medical volunteers. The women sent a desperate telegram home to Scotland. Dire necessity for fever nurses, equipment, mattresses, blankets, linen, milk, carbolic, castor oil.
They wore boots and they oiled the boots to prevent the lice climbing up the boots. Then they wore trousers and tucked the trousers into the boots. Then a gown, and then they put on rubber gloves and tucked the sleeves of the gown into the rubber gloves. And then somebody took bandages that were soaked in carbolic, and they bandaged their arms.
They worked in shifts, and but very often they never took their breaks at all. And a lot of the women suffered from exhaustion, and it was cold. I mean, it was just bitterly cold, with very, very little facilities for them to even get a break from it. So they worked round the clock.
The city of Valjevo was particularly badly hit. Every available public building here was turned into a hospital. Local historian Velibor Vidic is meeting Alan at the city's typhus cemetery.
Hello, Velibor.
Dobro došli.
Yeah, fine to you.
It
was horrible. Daily died from 100 to 200 people. There was an Orthodox custom when you bury a person, then the bells ring on the church. But then the bells stopped ringing because they were ringing all day long. There was not enough people who would bury the dying people. Would take them to the cemetery.
Neki su ležali u bolnicama po dan dva nesahranjeni jer nije imao ko da ih sahrani.
3,500 soldiers and 4,000 citizens were buried here. But nobody knows the number of refugees who were also coming here in thousands and dying and were buried.
Therefore, the role of the hospital provided by the Scottish Women's Hospitals
here would have been absolutely vital during those times. Is that correct?
Absolutely. They were treating everybody, and children especially. So it was very moving and touching. It was actually a precious thing to have these women over here.
Znamo da cenimo to što su vaši preci našima pomogli.
Our ancestors were hurt a lot, died a lot, and we appreciate, we know how to appreciate what your ancestors did for ours.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very, very much indeed. Thank you very much. Istina, stvarno.
It is true.
I can spend a great deal of time reading books and looking at various documents and museums, etc. But to actually physically be here, you know, and see what the cause and effect of World War One was, you know, it's just actually, you know, it's actually very moving just being here.
Sadly, before long, several of the Scottish Women's Hospital staff became infected with typhus. They are buried here, where they died. Among them, Madge Neil Fraser from Edinburgh. Augusto Minshew from North Wales. And little Louisa Jordan from Maryhill in Glasgow. Coming up in part three, worse horrors were about to unfold in Serbia.
Sometimes the people slipped. The screams were terrible.
And they probably felt at that point it was time to get out.
One 100 years ago, a group of Scottish female medics travelled through wartime Europe to nurse Serbia's sick and wounded. The volunteers of the Scottish Women's Hospital set off in January 1915 on their great adventure. Within weeks, several lost their lives to the typhus fever epidemic ravaging Serbia. By the summer of 1915, the disease was finally brought under control. Only then could the women properly take in the country. They were warmly embraced by the nation that they had helped, and they enjoyed many social occasions.
There was a period of calm and a time when things were very settled in Serbia, just for that summer. Women took the opportunity to enjoy the hospitality. They enjoyed everything from picnics to sports events. They danced the cola, and during that time, I think that's when this huge, almost love affair, if you like, happened between these two people.
At nights, they would have campfires, and the soldiers that were well enough would gather round, and sometimes they would sing in their native tongue.
Aunt Flo, at one of these fireside ceilidhs, was singing Feravata, a famous old Gaelic song.
This is such a lovely place. I seem to say that in every letter, wherever I write from, but it's perfectly true. Serbia is a lovely country. We are right among the hills here, and on this grey and misty morning, we could be in Scotland. Could any Scotswoman say anything more? But the blue, blue skies and sunshine, they are all Serbia. As with any group, there were occasional disagreements. These were strong women with equally strong personalities.
Evelina was a bit of a character, and there was constant fallouts between Evelina and various of some of the doctors and nurses. Elsie herself was no shrinking violet when it came to pulling them into line.
I know that there were a number of the women who were very too rubbed the wrong way with Evelina. I think there were some of the women who didn't approve of the short hair, the smoking, and the sort of galumphing, it was called. And there were a number of people who were not impressed at all and felt that she was a very bad influence. And yet, by the same token, there were any number of the young nurses and doctors who came out who adored Evelina. So she was quite a character.
It was during this time that the Serbs honoured the staff of the Scottish Women's Hospital with a new fountain of fresh drinking water. Alan is off to visit some people with a special connection to the fountain. Nenad and Vera from Belgrade have been working to keep the memory of the Scottish Women's Hospitals alive. Vera's late husband, Jarko, a doctor, organised for the fountain to be renovated in the 1980s. Mother and son are meeting Alan there.
Nemad. Vera. Hi, Vera.
Welcome.
Very, very pleased to meet you. Very
welcome to this beautiful fountain.
Thank you very much for showing me this. In memory of the Scottish Women's Hospitals in Serbia, and their founder, Dr Elsie Inglis, 1915.
My late husband and Nenad's father was the one who has started the renewment of the memories.
The soldiers would have just have come here basically and just built this from local stone. Is that correct?
Yes, yeah.
And I also understand the significance of the running water.
Yes.
That was something that Elsie Inglis was very keen to promote in Serbia at that particular time.
The hospital was not far away, and because there was water here, fountain was built between the city and the hospital.
The Serbians gave a pretty speech saying how grateful they were to the Scottish Women's Hospitals and that they were a poor people and cannot do big things. But they had done this little thing to show how grateful they were and to keep the name of the hospitals forever in the countryside. I felt, as a suffragist who can speak, I ought to give a speech in reply. I simply thanked them 1,000 times, and they did not seem to expect anything more. And then, invasion. Austrian, Bulgarian and German forces had surrounded Serbia on all sides. The country was in chaos, and without Allied reinforcements, its already damaged army knew it had little hope of keeping the enemy at bay.
By September of 1915, the Serbs were outnumbered by 10 to 1. They virtually surrounded the entire country, and Serbia knew that with no help, they were just going to put their own men into a situation where they'd be slaughtered. I think it was something that upset Elsie in a very big way.
The Scottish woman had to make a decision: stay and face the enemy, or join the mass exodus heading for the mountains of Albania. The whole nation was on the move.
This wasn't them running away. This, they decided that they would go into retreat and try and get the men rearmed, fresh, to take the fight back into Serbia when that day would come.
They'd split up into three groups, one group staying, one group going south, and one group going north. And Mary was on the group going south. They took with them patients that were able, any patients that were able to walk, went with them.
The women who went on the retreat, I think they honestly believed they could use their skills to help. They found very quickly with the winter storms and with the serious climbing of mountains and with the sheer volume of people that it was actually a case of every man for themselves.
The procession, as it dipped into the hollow and reappeared on the crest to dip and reappear again, looked like a great dragon wandering over the countryside, stretching from one end of Serbia to the other. And one realized that this was something more than an army retiring. It was the passing of a whole nation into exile, a people leaving a lost country.
The path was extremely slippery because so many people had been walking on it, so it was in packed ice. You had normal shoes, and your shoes were worn because you'd been walking for weeks. And she said that was really scary. They were terrified, and sometimes the people slipped. And she said the screams were terrible.
Tragically, one of the Scottish Women's Hospital nurses, Caroline Tuffel, never made it home. The motor ambulance she was travelling in lost its grip on the icy road and rolled into a precipice. Caroline fractured her skull. She died 3 days later. Fellow nurses recalled how a cry of Salve Carolina rang out across the mountainside as she was lowered into the ground in a roughly hewn soldier's coffin. Alan is walking on one of the sections of road that the retreating women would have taken.
The women would have travelled on routes just like this. Mary McKenzie, Caroline, Tuffhill would have all travelled down these roads, 400 to 500 miles long, and would have taken them anywhere between 5 and 7 weeks in the dead of winter. These roads would have been covered in snow and ice, eventually turning to deep, deep mud, and would have been littered with the bodies of the men, women and children that were retreating from Serbia in 1915. You know, and I'm looking at the way the road is now, you know, it's new tar on it. Cars and lorries are jumping up and down here. And what a contrast from 100 years ago when this would have been the only type of road in and out of these mountains.
While the women who had joined the retreat made their treacherous journey, the remaining party, including Elsie and Evelina, were facing their own ordeals. They were being held by the invading army in the town of Kraljevo, unable to leave or communicate with the outside world.
They just wouldn't give up on their hospitals. I think Elsie Inglis was up for a fight. I think that she knew that they would get pretty rough treatment. And I think she was up for it. Conditions gradually got worse, but the relationship soon deteriorated.
Meat and wood are very scarce, and we are in constant fear that they may come to an end. The commissaire has to be given a box of cigarettes before he'll give us the sugar we're entitled to. Our little store of tinned food is getting very low. Today, some of the meat was so bad that two of our people could eat nothing.
Vera and Evelina stayed behind. Vera kept a diary and sort of said, you know, there are more Germans on the street now. And Evelina complained because everybody was taking up her time asking her to translate. And really, she wanted to help the Serbian people. She got as bossy with those Germans as she did with everybody else, and continued to work in the hospitals.
They were all in one room in a kind of an old rickety-rackety hotel. You know, about 40 women to one room. So it was uncomfortable for as well as everything else. And they probably felt at that point it was time to get out.
Coming up in part four, the women return home, but it wasn't the end of their Serbian story.
Evelina kind of worked herself to death, it seems to me.
And it's Alan's turn to pay tribute. One 100 years ago, a group of Scottish female medics travelled through wartime Europe to nurse Serbia's sick and wounded. For the volunteers of the Scottish Women's Hospital, this was their great adventure. Months later, they were fleeing for their lives through treacherous winter mountains. Some of the women never made it home. Finally, in December 1915, many of the women who'd taken part in the Great Serbian Retreat arrived back in Britain.
They were heroes. I mean, the story was well told. It was in the papers. It was just one of it was a morale-boosting story in many ways, that these women had survived this epic journey.
When Mary arrived in London, she had a boot on one foot and a shoe on the other foot, neither being hers. She looked like a vagabond. And Queen Mary was greeting her and the other Scottish Women's Hospital ladies.
A month later, the 50 or so women who were still being held as prisoners of war in Serbia were released. They arrived home in February 1916.
A lot of the women were actually very sick, though, when they came back. They were probably just, it was a case of just exhaustion, and they had lost an awful lot of weight. I mean, Elsie Inglis herself, she was not well really right from the get-go with us. She'd lost a heck of a weight. I mean, to their credit, a lot of the women, even shortly after they came back, even in the space of maybe 2-3 months, signed up to join another unit, and off they went again.
Flo McKenzie from Lochinver nursed throughout the war, but sadly her sister Mary became ill and wasn't able to return to her profession.
They didn't say what the condition was, because in those days tuberculosis carried a bit of a stigma. Because of that, she never went back out. And the medals were given out towards the end of the war. Flo had a shoebox full of medals. She had a lot of medals. Mary had 2. That was all. Although she'd the much harder war.
After they'd recuperated, many of the women joined field hospitals in Western Europe and the Mediterranean, where the Serbian army was recovering on the islands of Corsica and Corfu. But some of them were determined to return to Serbia, and a party, including Elsie and Evelina, travelled to Russia, hoping to return from the north.
I think they were very disappointed as to what had happened in Serbia. They felt that they had abandoned them somehow, and they wanted to be there. Elsie, by that stage, her health was fading. The women didn't know, because she wouldn't tell them. They just thought that she was continually contracting various illnesses along the way.
Elsie's health deteriorated, and she was forced to return home on a ship travelling via the Arctic Circle. She never did reach Serbia again. She arrived in Newcastle on November the 25th, 1917.
She asked for some of her closest friends to gather around, and she explained to them that, you know, she had cancer and that she wouldn't make it through the night. So it was a very difficult time, just having done all that and only just making it back to the shores. So particularly sad for Elsie Inglis, because it would have been interesting to see what kind of career she would have had afterwards.
In 1918, after a hard war with losses amounting to one-third of its population, the Serbian nation finally regained its country, moving up through Greece in a series of fierce battles. The Scottish women's hospitals were always at their side. For some, including Evelina, it wasn't the end of their Serbian story.
After the war was over, she returned to Serbia, because she loved the people, she loved the music, she loved the countryside.
Evelina and her partner Vera returned to Serbia to help children orphaned by war. But just 10 months into their mission, Evelina became ill.
Evelina kind of worked herself to death, it seems to me. She would take chances with her health. She didn't get any rest. She was absolutely driven. This is a photograph of Evelina. I think it must be after the war, because all of a sudden now she's much thinner. And this is a photograph that was taken in here in Belgrade. She had double pneumonia and was ill for a few days. She died in a little house. Vera was at her side. And Evelina was laid out on a bed of rosemary. I think that it's a good thing that she's buried here in Serbia. Whereas before I thought, how could she be so far from her family, you know? But she loved Serbia, and the Serbian people loved her right back.
After some years in Paris and America, Flo McKenzie returned to the Highlands, where she and her sister Mary shared a house for the rest of their lives.
Flo never married, and Mary married but was widowed quite soon after she married, unfortunately. My memory of them as old ladies, Mary would be busy knitting or preparing a meal or doing something. She'd be sitting in the corner, knitting furiously, and Flo would be sitting on the other side of the kitchen in Oak Villa, which is where they normally sat, smoking with her long ebony cigarette holder.
With his trip to Serbia over, Alan has come to Edinburgh, where he has some final respects to pay.
Well, I'm looking for Elsie Inglis' grave. It's in the Dean Cemetery here in Edinburgh. The last time I was here, the grave was in quite a poor state of affairs. It was covered in moss and algae. You couldn't read the writing.
Alan has arranged for Elsie Inglis' headstone to be cleaned up. And today, he's arranged a tribute to an extraordinary Scotswoman.
That looks like a bit like it. Yep, here we are. This lady rallied the troops, so to speak. She was a pioneer for medicine. She was also a fantastic ambassador to her country. She, for a short period, she became the mother of the Serbian people. You know, here we are. Yeah, yeah. Very nice.
I think a lot of the women, especially in the Scottish Women's Hospital Unit, they had something to prove. They wanted to prove that they could fight, that they were equal to men.
Yes, I think they did a tremendous amount for showing that women were able to hold responsible positions. They were every bit as good as the men in the family.
It was a remarkable achievement. There was so many odds stacked against them right from the start. And to have ended up in Serbia of all places, fighting and helping the people, I just think it's remarkable.